here on time. Okay, let's start. Thank you very much. Today's presentation, inshallah, is going to be about effective care and group work and handling the problems of large groups of students, as we, most of our classes, have a large number of students. Okay, so first of all, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Walid Shawky. I think the old hands know me, maybe new ones may not. So my name is Walid Shawky. I graduated from Azhar University in 2000. And I did my BA, MBA, sorry, at the University of Edinburgh in 2013 in the field of TESOL. Okay. So I've been teaching here at KAU for around 6 years now. I joined KAU at 2010. The overview of the workshop. In this workshop, inshallah, we are going to start with the importance of care and group work. How important are they in our classrooms for us as teachers and for our students as well? Then we're going to look at the advantages and disadvantages of care and group work, as it has some advantages, it also has some disadvantages. Okay, that we need to look at. Then we need to have a look at the solutions and the problems, the challenges and the solutions to these problems. Then dealing with large numbers of students, and finally the practical part, if the time allows, we're going to do this part. Okay? In the first part, we're going to work in pairs, looking at the importance of pair and group work activities. So you're going to work with a partner, so we work in two, you work here. Can you please work together?
Yes.
Yes. Is there anyone here? Yeah, you're going to work with them. So we work here. Okay. I think you can work with group of three.
But tomorrow.
So you're going to we have to two, until this person comes. Okay. Keep working for free. Okay, the first question is, do you put students into pairs and groups for various activities in your classrooms? Why or why not? Okay, I'll give you 2 minutes to think about this question. Do you do that in your classrooms and why? Okay, go ahead with a partner, discuss the idea.
Why?
Okay.
Relations with people and in person, for me, or with the person.
Okay.
So I believe that most teachers do use it now, right? Do use peer and group work activities in the classrooms for various reasons. But the next question is, how often do you do this? How often do you use peer and group work activities in your classroom? Do you do it every day? Do you do it once or twice a week? And what are the reasons for trying to limit the number of peer work activities or enhance the number of peer and group work activities? Again, in your, with your partner, think of this question. How often do you do this? And do you think there is a chance, there is an opportunity to use it more often? And why?
Easy.
I think it's a controversial issue because some people may think that using group work activities in the classroom actually saves more time than any other activities, because instead of giving each one or each two students an opportunity to speak, you give all students an opportunity to speak at the same time. So instead of listening to one student, you can listen to like 15, 20, 30 students. Of course, you as a teacher cannot listen to every single student, but you can go around and you can check and make sure that everybody is participating or saying something instead of listening to one person.
If you have a large group, group work is effective, more effective in the student scale.
Okay, group work is more effective with large groups, and that's what we're going to have a look at later in the session, inshallah. So we do agree that almost everybody here uses play and group work activities in their classrooms. Now you're going to work with another partner, so you're going to work here this time, okay? And try to test how important do you think it is to vary the classroom interaction and why. Now, what I mean by vary here is not just pair and group work activities. I mean using pair work, using individual work, using teacher to student interaction, student to the teacher interaction. These are all different types of interaction that goes on in the classroom. So, can you please, with your partner, try to listen, how important do you think it is to vary the classroom interaction? Together? So, here, yes, this time. Yeah? Change the partner. Okay. Yes, maybe more than three.
Thank you.
Dr. Adil has got some important points to raise. So how would you expect to have a duty-carry group work activity? What do you expect to happen? What do you expect students to do if you're there and you're working?
Oh, yeah. It depends on the task, actually. And like, for example, as I was showing you earlier, have that if it's a process writing activity, I expect them to, depending, for example, it could be the pre-writing task where we are giving them new vocabulary. I want them to be able to interact with the vocabulary or whatever kind of task we're giving them, gaffe or attach a piece of paper to the writing task. That is what I want them to do. If it's a speaking activity, for example, and if I put two guys together, I give them a point, I say, do you agree or disagree with that? I expect them to discuss that. However, the downfall there is, and I remember like a little while ago, one of our colleagues, Brother Mehmet Rekab, like he also had a presentation with me when we used to have the town hall workshops at that time. And the point that he brought up was that, how do we know that anything is happening?
Yes.
It's just the sound, is that proof enough?
The noise, that's amazing.
And just a teacher going around, that's not enough. For example, by the time I move from Y and I go to Badan Tov, by the time I'm in Y, it's making paper airplanes.
Yeah.
Sorry, Ryan. The point there, so what my personal solution for that was what we call that proof, quote unquote.
You mean the product that students have
done? The product, and how you show it to me. The example that I gave to they have was that, for example, if it's a speaking activity, and a speaking activity is about whether they agree or disagree on a certain point, like I asked them to jot down in bullet points, like what were the specific points of agreement or disagreement, stuff like that, something that would let me see with my eyes what it was that happened there.
Okay, thank you. Yes, any other
questions? The last question, how do you know they are able to do it? Forced to make sure that you give them enough input before the time, enough language, to be able to do the specific things.
So the language, you make sure that they have the language ability, the linguistic ability to use this or to produce something, the task.
And also put the emphasis on the instructions.
Instructions also sometimes important because you need students to know what exactly is going on. Sometimes you need to model at the beginning of the activity to see, to show them what is expected of them to do. In this part, so I want you to have a look at the picture. What's happening in this picture? They are a group of students. Okay, they are interacting. How do you think they feel?
Happy.
They're happy, right? They are motivated, right? Yeah. Okay, so that kind of brings the idea of CLT. Can you please remind me what the CLT stands for?
You can read the language
teaching. Communicative language teaching. What is the focus of communicative language teaching? It's the
product
of the language. Okay. You mean fluency or accuracy?
Fluency.
Okay.
It depends. You know, whether they have a strong version or a weak version.
Okay.
So
a strong version.
Well, a strong version is more focused on fluency.
Okay. And
the weaker version is more focused on the combination of accuracy and fluency.
So what do you care about most in your classroom?
With these books.
So what do you care most in your classroom? Accuracy or fluency?
Both, because this is what you're doing with the book. The book is like a weak version.
But for our students, from our students' perspective, what do they care more about?
Well, this is a whole different story, because what our students need is more reading skills.
Yes.
And this is integrated skills, you know, book.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we should basically be supplementing this with more reading, because that's what they're going to need after in the second year and third year.
Because I need to look at the students often think about the exams that's coming ahead, so they need to be careful about accuracy more. Okay, but so you as a teacher,
we are after accuracy.
It means
if we teach you vocab and grammar,
yeah,
we are after accuracy.
Vocab and grammar.
Yeah.
Okay, but I think still vocabulary can be used for fluency as well, right? Yeah. Anyway, the main focus of CLT or communicative language teaching is on communication as a goal of learning the new language and also as the process of learning a language. Okay, it actually reinforces the importance or encourages pair and group work activities in the classroom. In this part, we're going to work in groups of four, Okay, and we need to try to list the importance of using pair and group work activities. I need a list this time. We need to write a list of pair and of the importance of pair and group work activities in your class. So,
I work.
That's
white paper.
Thank you.
Authentic materials are frequently used. When we ask students to work in pairs or groups, we usually assign a task, and this task often comes from the environment around them. Like, sometimes you ask students to tell about their own experience, their previous experience, for example, to produce a story, to write about a past experience. So it's all authentic. They all think of their own lives, and they activate their schema, and they talk about the things that they went through before.
This is the main principle of society.
Yeah.
Which was developed by an Indian teacher. This is an aspect. Teachers to teach language, okay, in imaginary situation.
Imaginary situations.
Change the process into theater space.
Mm-hmm. So the students actually act in the classroom. Okay. Multi-answers are possible because the students come from different cultures, so everyone comes with a different answer. They have different backgrounds, so if it's a social part, usually the answers vary according to the city or the area that they come from. Okay? And for you as a teacher, you can get all these answers and you can correct the ones that need to be corrected. Mistakes are still part of learning. Students talk, they speak freely, they are not worried. Because they talk to classmates and they're not afraid of making mistakes in front of the teacher or other students, and they can, as we discussed, they can learn from other students as well. Learners have more speaking time. Yeah, instead of one student speaks at a time, everybody speaks at the same time. Also, it changes the pace of the lesson. Instead of the teacher giving most of the talk, now there's a change with individual work, and then pair work, and then group work, so the students never feel bored during the classroom. Moves the spotlight from the teacher to the student, as some of our colleagues said, it reduces the teacher talk time and increases the student talk time. It allows the students to mix with everyone in the group. It actually gives students a good opportunity to know each other well. So, for example, if you ask students during the group work to tell which student in your group, for example, has been to Dubai. So they need to ask each individual in the group, and they know about each other's lives. So they get more connected to each other. They know each other much better. A sense of achievement when reaching a team goal. If there is an activity, a task, by the end of the task, students feel that, yeah, I was able to do something at the end, especially with low-level students. Teaches students how to lead and be led. Usually in a group, we assign roles, so they're usually like a mentor, could be a language mentor sometimes, somebody who makes sure that everybody uses the second language or the first language. There could be a writer sometimes, there could be a presenter sometimes. So there are rules for students in each group, and they know who is the leader of this, and the others know how to be led. It allows teacher to monitor, move, and really listen, as we were discussing here. The teacher can go around the classroom, listen to the students, and he can actually assess what's going on. He makes sure that every student is working on the right track, and they are doing the activity required effectively and in the right way. Now we're going to have a look not just at the advantages that we were discussing, now we're going to look also at the disadvantages of pair and group work activities. In this part, you're going to work alone. What you need to do is, we have a passage here, okay? I want each individual within 3 minutes, or let's make it 4 minutes, to try to put the sentences in the right order so the passage makes sense. Okay, individually. Yes, please.
This is called this kind of thing.
Okay.
So the instruction is here. Put the lines into the correct order that the whole paragraph makes sense. Okay. You have 1, 6, and 12 already done. Okay. 1 and 6 and 12. They have already answered and they've crossed out in the list out there.
Thank you.
Okay, done? Finished? How many have already finished? Well, I can see that most of you have already finished. So, in 1 minute, could you please work with a partner and compare glances? Bottom of the page, you may find the answer, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. But there is a link here. Okay, at the bottom of the page, under the lines that can guide you through the answers to this. Anyway, what are the answers? It's actually going through the alphabetical order, except L. It starts with L, and then you go through the alphabetical order. It's A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L. It's a library. Okay. Here is the answer. The task now is still in the same group of four. I want you to answer this question here in this next part at the bottom of the page. What do you think are the most interesting, surprising, or useful points in the text? Again, the text here in the right order, so you can have a look at if it's not really clear yet. Okay? So the text is here. Look at the text and see what are the most interesting or surprising or you think important facts in this passage. And take notes. I put it in color so you can know where the stop, where each line stops and where the other line starts.
Say that. I'm not saying it's right.
what is something you find interesting? Nothing interesting. Nothing surprising. Social setting. So he thinks that. Okay, teaching and learning occur through social interaction between teachers and students in classrooms as well as two people. Where is the word social setting?
The first line.
Social interaction between teachers and students. Classrooms and social settings.
Yes.
Okay, so you, this is surprising for you?
No.
Why is it so?
Because they know they can practice language in a meaningful situation or within context, but life is meaningful, but they have real reason for learning it.
I mean, if you think about the classroom as a place where you meet new friends, when you get introduced to new people, I think it's still a social setting. Maybe the wording, friends say, but it's still for me, it's a social situation where you can meet people and know new friends, make new friends. Yeah, what's interesting here? Do you find something?
It's a kind of engaging society.
Yes.
And such I observe the certain things in their life. And to ask what certain person answers them from another student, as if he wants to help him.
Yeah. Okay. So it's still a miniature society. Students need to help each other. Okay.
Yeah, that social, that emphasizes the interaction between the teacher and the students, and the students and the students.
Okay.
Yeah, that's really useful.
Thank you. Yes, anything
else? I got one you like, don't worry.
Okay.
I was surprised, to answer your question, that this guy, Mr. Herbert A. Feldman, is basically affirming what I usually do, which is unfortunately or fortunately not doing too much group repair work. He's affirming that my work with the whole class is in fact at that work with the dynamic group.
It is.
Yeah. So I do group work just with one big group that's in a miniature society with many subgroups.
Yeah, it is.
So according to him, he's affirming our...
But you're right.
I like it.
Okay. So if you look back at this activity that we have done, what do you think? What kind of activity is this? What kind of activities that we have just done right now? Not the last one. I mean, since the handout is given to you.
We started to be building a campaign. Increase the participation level from zero.
From single student, from individual work, to pair, and then to group work activity. Yeah. Actually, we call this kind of activity, we call it think, bear, share. Okay. What are the three stages? Okay, of this activity. How many stages did we go through in this activity? How many?
Three.
The first one is individual, okay, and then pair, and then group work activity, okay? So how did you feel during each stage? How did you feel during the first stage when you were working alone?
Great.
With this? Great. It's much better than working in a group. Okay, how did you feel? Was the text easy? It was challenging, right?
Yeah.
So you feel that you were challenged, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay. Confused sometimes because the text was not easy to answer. Okay. And how did you feel during the second stage? When you were working with another more
reassuring?
Yes. You feel, you know, you're getting help from someone else. You're getting supported. Okay. And how about the third stage? How do you feel during the third stage when you were working in a group? I think your role gets smaller and smaller and smaller from the very beginning. I was doing everything, now I have somebody else to share, and then I always get smaller in a group of four. Okay? What is the purpose of this type of activity? Why do we do this kind of activity? To show that? Okay, we actually valued the types of interaction in each stage of the lesson. We started with individual, then pair, then group, so there was different types of interaction. Okay, what changes or modifications can you make in this activity to fit your own particular class that you're teaching during this module? You're teaching a class in this module, okay, and you might be doing something like this. Do you think that You can, if you're going to use this kind of activity, think, pair, share, you're going to use it in the same way, or there's some other modifications or changes that you would like to do to fit your specific students. Okay, 1 minute to think about this. I give you 1 minute to think about this. If you're going to use it in the same way or make some changes.
I totally follow this.
Yeah.
mainly come from the students, yes?
All the students are aware of the importance of parent group. I never seen them before going to the university.
Yeah, maybe because of the bad experience before, they have never tried it before, mm-hmm. and that's something new to them, and they know how important it could be.
Yeah.
Yeah. Students level, the multi-level they have in the class.
They digress to N1.
Okay, the tendency to use N1, especially when they are working in parent group. Mm. Any other challenges?
Lack of interest.
Lack of interest from the student side. From the student. So if they're
not interested, even if you're going to motivate them, they're not interested.
Okay. Yeah, that's one reason. Other challenges. Again?
Some students are lazy.
Yeah, good students do usually dominate, they control everything while shy or low-level students, you know, hide behind them.
Over-dependence on others sometimes.
Yes, it's the same idea, over-dependence. Yeah.
Lack of language.
Lack of language ability to produce.
Set instructions.
Okay. Yeah, so that comes from the teacher, I guess. The instructions are clear, or not valid according to the level of the students. Anything, any ideas, any other ideas?
Using mobile phones in class.
Again, it's
using the mobile phones in class.
It's true. I think this also depends on the level of engagement. If they are actually interested in doing something in the classroom, they will. If not, they usually tend to play with the mobile phones.
Should it be actually out of the book, if you don't read one of them on their book or this part of you?
Yeah.
Choose reading the same text.
Exactly, it's true. So, we've got some of the challenges here that quickly, some students quickly switch from English to Arabic, okay? They often make too much noise, okay, that sometimes disturbs other groups to work.
Yeah.
They soon get bored if the activity is too long, especially for good students who finish early and they find nothing to do, okay, while other students are still working in the same activity. They do not participate. Okay, if they are not actually motivated, if they don't see the value of this, I keep actually pushing my students to participate in peer and group work activities every time, and they just sit like this. And they often complain because they don't practice English enough, they don't have opportunities to practice. And some of them say, we would like to travel to the UK or to the US to practice English. And I say, you're here, you're given the opportunity to practice here, but you don't use it. Okay? So, some of them don't understand the activity, or sometimes their instruction is vague, or maybe it's above the student's level. Some good students, as we said, finish early and they get bored, they find nothing to do. Okay, now what about the solutions to these challenges? Okay, very often there isn't one single challenge that you face during paid and group work activities. Sometimes you have all these challenges come together, or maybe two or three of them in the same activity. So you have one good student who finished early, another student who doesn't understand the instruction, another two students who are using the other one. So multi-challenges may come in one single activity. And sometimes one solution may work with more than one. Like for example, monitoring. Monitoring or effective monitoring technique during peer and group work activities sometimes solves more than one of these problems. So sometimes there are many challenges, okay, and sometimes there is one solution that can help with all these challenges, or more than one. Now, you're going to work in pairs. In this part, for each of the six challenges that we have just seen, I would like you to write at least two solutions, okay? Just as an example, some students quickly switch from Arabic to English, so a good idea here is could be like monitor closely or give incentives. Okay, so the first group or the best group will get an extra mark, or they will leave early or something like this. So at least, I mean, what kind of incentives do you think we can give to our students?
You can go.
So this is a reward or a punishment?
Punishment. You have to do something like press ups or stand in the middle of the class or
which has followed me around the class wherever I go. Well, like some of the suggestions that I got from some teachers is to have a list of the best student of the day, for example, or the student of the week, something like this. So you can have like a name list here with a tick with the best student or something like this. Okay? I know we cannot give extra marks for this, but at least there is a way, at least a clap or a praise sometimes for the incentives.
Haram?
Okay, we need fatwa for this. I can't tell that yet. Okay, so looking back at the challenges.
If you're happy, you may. It's a whole problem.
Okay, let's look back at the challenges, please, quickly, in 2 minutes. Try to find at least 2 solutions to each of these challenges in pairs. So, work together in pairs, you work here, you work together, please. 2, 2, 2, and my question is to you.
From that, they don't know what they're doing. It's talking about the environment. So they have to, if they're, he knows what to do, and the others know what to do.
So assign roles for each student, so they know what exactly they are doing during the group work. Okay, that's a good idea. Any other solutions?
You can ask some students as monitors.
Do you think it's suitable for university students? Or elementary?
That's right. But just to give them this feeling that
they're being watched. Get soon, get bored. Some students get bored very quickly.
After the beginning, extra work, some extra tasks for them, or maybe as
monitoring, helping from other groups. I think differentiating the activity for good students, you might create a more challenging activity and less challenging for low level students. Okay. What about students who don't participate, who are reluctant to speak in English or to say something, to do something?
Motivation.
How?
Incentive.
Encouraging them to say something. Maybe support them or help them or give them some guides. Okay.
One incentive is when you do the groups, pick one student and say, I want the answer from you before the discussion starts.
Yeah.
And that puts pressure on the
candidate. Yeah. Assign him as a presenter of the group, for example.
That's
sometimes you sit with the group yourself for some time and encourage those people who are not participating more to ask them for their views or something.
Okay. To speak or to say something. And if it's difficult for the students, you can provide some vocabulary at the beginning of the activity. You can give them a structure that they can follow later during the activity. So they try to make it easy for your students. What if they don't understand the task?
Make it easier.
Punish the teacher.
Your teacher said one solution can solve more than one problem. So I'm suggesting we can also use punishment to solve as well.
If they don't understand, you punish them?
Yeah, understand.
Let me say.
This is the major purpose of having a group work.
Yeah.
To reuse resources from within the group. Mm-hmm. So people who have understood the task, they can make others understand. Right. The first thing that they do is understand the task from each other.
Exactly, yeah. That's a good idea, because they usually, if they don't understand, they ask their classmates. What are we going to do? This is the first question they ask. So re-teaching the vocabulary might help.
Exactly. Or also telling them to stay at home. Especially if they're behind you, stay at home. Some students see the study when those in class, they don't stay when they go home. That's a big problem.
Some? Yeah. This is also my comment. So what about do students who finish early?
This is the show.
You see the solutions here in the picture? When you finish early, you may read, do a puzzle, make a finger puppet, play a game, or visit the shop.
5 minutes.
Do you think you can do something like this?
Yeah,
I think you can assign them something extra to do. Okay, well, we're going to ask them to join other groups to help. Like, if you finish in this group, you can join this group and see how far they have achieved.
I can add to the menu. Use your mobile.
Everybody will finish early in this case.
That's it.
Okay. So we need to write for each of the 6 challenges. Write down. We finish this part. Okay. And here in groups of 4, I would like you to think of the most common challenge that you usually face in your classrooms during pair and group work activities. Okay, and discuss what is the most appropriate solution within your group. Okay, to effectively overcome this problem. So think of the problems that you usually have when you teach. Okay, pair and group work activities. What is the most common one within the group? Okay, find one problem, or likely two, that you think are too common, and what is the solution to the problem? Yeah, 1, 2, 3.
give it 5%.
And we think that the top management can intervene in one way or the other. Their
were two suggestions in this group that from the top management there should be some policy. So for example, attendance is one. Like for example, if someone is not taking interest, we give him reminder 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
After the 3 reminders, that person should be reported to someone responsible, maybe in student affairs or in the top management somehow, who should give that student 5 absences.
Okay, so
that's one. And then brother contributed that there should be some marks given to the prerogative of this teacher, 10 or 15 marks.
Yeah.
The teachers have this authority in his hand. Okay, best students will get this.
Okay, so it's the solution. The solution is not in the teacher's hand. You mean in the stakeholders of the
policy.
You take the students. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Any other problems?
Yeah. I'm teaching level one with Peter.
Yeah.
One of the major problems I'm facing now is that they finish early because they're using old books.
Mm. Oh, they already have the answers.
They already have the answers. I mean, sometimes. I don't do this like every day, but sometimes I design different activities to reach the same outcome.
Okay, so you verify that they've changed the whole activity.
Yeah.
Maybe the outcome is the same, but the process and the goal and the activity itself is different. Okay, what are the solutions? Let's listen.
I'm doing the same. I'm teaching level one repeaters, and they do have the workbook which is already answered.
Yeah.
So I asked them, I said, okay, you're not going to buy a new one, so in that case, you have to find from another class, classmate, who you can make a copy of his, the new one, and you won't be allowed to be in class without having a copy of the workbook.
Copying is an issue.
It's only for exercise. The student book. It's for the workbook.
Okay.
And he already has one.
I mean, but the teacher is not here to hear this.
This is what
according to the body impression of the regulations. This is not a violation of policy.
He has his correction, but he is doing nothing because he's already has.
Okay.
It's like.
And this is something we have no control
over.
Yeah, now we're going to move to another part of the session. It is dealing with large number of students. Okay? At the very beginning, I want you to think of what is a large number? What do we mean by large number of students? Okay, so can you try to answer this question? What is it? What is a large number of students?
But before that, we have to.
Thank you. let's now look at the answers. So there are always enough students to participate. Okay, two more groups. Any other possible answers for the first spin? Okay. We get a rich variety of
students.
Activities. Again, activities, challenges, ideas, resources, and outcomes. Okay. Okay. The teacher is not the only decision maker. What?
Source of
knowledge.
Focus.
Yes.
Speaker.
Okay, because the focus usually means the students. We're never bored. We're never responsible.
Never die.
What do you mean?
I mean that not one individual is identifies to be responsible for anything. So it is a group responsibility, shared responsibility.
Okay. So we are never only responsible, or the only one responsible for something. Professional development occurs
continuously.
Yes.
Every time we have a break.
Like, so it works only to you have professional development. Oh, we're not talking about us as teachers. It's teachers. We're talking about students. Cares in the UI.
Professional development occurs every time you have a break at UI.
Okay. This is an individual question. Okay, these are some of the possible answers. There are always enough students for interaction. Okay. We get a rich variety of human resources. You've got many students with different backgrounds. The teacher is not the only source of knowledge. He's not the only monitor. Not the only giver of knowledge, we can say. We're never bored. Professional development occurs naturally or through practice, we can say. Okay. Okay, now you're going to work in pairs, and then for each of the advantages, right, and disciplinary support, excellence, and one thing you need to do this. Okay. Yeah, that's it, right? Okay, so my part is over.